Why did you click this video? You had hundreds of options, but you clicked on this one. Was it your choice? Did you do it out of your own free will, or did every single incident in your life over the course of your brief existence led up to this moment of you clicking this video? Were you always supposed to click it at this time of this day? We think we are free. We believe in choices, at least I did when I was growing up. The idea that things are predetermined and I might just be a puppet in this show offended me. I thought, you always have a choice. But now, I'm not so certain. But I understand choices. Choices create drama. The thought that we could have prevented an accident or chosen another better path gives us a sense of control, which in turn gives this existence a texture. If everybody knows everything is determined already, and this is how things will unfold, then there is no place for that sense of control. You're just watching a movie, and that has terrifying implications. My dad is intensely religious. He believes in a deterministic universe. According to his religion, everything that's happening has already happened and will continue to happen. It is an infinite cycle. There is no doer, but just an illusion of things being done. This thought is ingrained in him. But no matter how deep someone's belief of a deterministic universe goes, they still can't let go of their sense of control. Wouldn't a deterministic universe free you from all possible responsibilities? If everything is predetermined, then what are you really responsible for? The word karma means action. It is the concept of eternal cause and effect. It has its origin in ancient India, and it is the principal idea behind many Asian religions. Karmic activity is said to be an action performed with an intention. Reflexes and unintentional actions are not karmic activities. Beating heart and muscle reflexes are not karmic actions, as you don't have to decide to do that. Imagine you're sitting still in a beautiful garden. The garden has trees, flowers, flowing water, and the songs of various birds. You could be sitting, breathing, and just being. You hear the songs of the birds, you notice the colors of the flower, and without any sense of the self, doing something. The minute you think, I am going to hear the sound of this bird, that begins the karmic activity. It is an intentional cause, and according to karma, that cause will have an effect. Karma is said to be an eternal cause and effect with knots interlinked, which in turn provides all the texture and drama that we witness all around us. But it's not as simple as it sounds. Today, I had a pizza for lunch at a new pizza shop in the city. I only went to that pizza shop after I saw an ad poster during my visit to the visa processing office. I only went to the visa processing office as I was in the process of immigrating to another country. I only decided to move to another country as I applied for an overseas job on LinkedIn. Did I eat pizza for lunch today only because I applied for the job all those months ago? And what influenced that decision? But one could argue that it is possible for a completely different scenario to have happened. But the truth is, it didn't. This was the only outcome. If you focus on any of your decisions, you would always find another previous decision that influenced the one in focus. So do you think you have a say in any of this? Can you control and redirect the events in your life? Or are you just a kid in a toy car pretending to drive?
Is there a scientific basis for the concept of free will in human beings? And if not, is there a biological evolutionary reason why all of us believe we have free will?
The late Christopher Hitchens, when asked, does he believe in free will, replied, I have no choice. It's a question that I dread, actually, because I don't have a very well thought out view about it. I think that, I mean, I have a materialist view of the world. I think that that things are determined in a rational way by antecedent events. And so that commits me to the view that when I think I have free will, when I think that I'm exercising free choice, I'm deluding myself, that I'm, my brain states are determined by physical events. And yet that seems to contradict, to go against the very powerful subjective impression that we all have, that we do have free will.
Some time ago, my friend casually said something while addressing free will and determinism. He said, "You have a choice until you make a decision. After that, it was always supposed to happen that way." It might sound like a nonsensical statement at first, but when you closely examine it, you realize that it's not nonsensical, it's paradoxical. It is in line with all the other laws of paradoxes that seem to govern almost all aspects of our reality. We looked at this through the lens of cause-consequence cycle and determinism. But what about free will? What are its implications? Free will is the ability to make a conscious choice at any given moment without any external coercion while also accepting the responsibility for one's action. This is where the concept of morality comes in. According to free will, you're morally responsible for your actions. You chose to do it, you could have prevented it, and you didn't, so you are responsible for it. So, what is true freedom? Being caught in an infinite cause-consequence cycle and going through the motions while watching your life like a movie without any responsibility? Or consciously choosing to do an action and being responsible for that action and its consequence? It doesn't seem like it was our choice to come into this world. We didn't seem to choose our family. We even appear to be predisposed to behave in a certain way. The idea of psychological archetypes was researched and advanced by Swiss psychiatrist Carl Jung. Archetype is a collectively inherited idea or a pattern of thought that is universally present in individual psyches. Jung divided the mind into three layers. According to Jung, these three layers shape a person's identity. The first one is the conscious or the ego world, which is formed by your direct experience of this world through your senses like sight, sound, and smell. The next layer would be personal unconscious, which includes anything that's not blatantly accessible to our awareness but can be. This includes both memories that can be remembered and the painfully suppressed ones. Then he adds a spectacularly unique world to our mind called the collective unconscious. It is a river of humanity's experiences, a knowledge that we are all born with. Although we can't be conscious of it, it strongly influences our experiences, behaviors, and our relationship with our reality. According to Jung, this collective unconscious begins even before we are born, like how the physical organs form in the mother's womb. The contents of this collective unconscious are called the archetypes, and it is there to influence how we behave in certain situations, and it stands outside of what we call reality. The innocent, the caregiver, the orphan, the hero are some of the common ego types that Jung describes. But we could have endless debates about whether we are really free or merely unconscious actors mouthing dialogues and actions that the invisible script demands of us. But it doesn't change the fact that we still feel in control. We feel guilty, sad, happy, proud, and emotionally responsible for our actions. These built-in emotional responses go hand in hand in thinking that we are free. And in turn, I realized that the very construct of this reality depends upon this illusion of freedom. We might very well be puppets, but the whole existence depends upon us not realizing that. I love producing this web series and I have a lot of fascinating things planned for this channel. But each of these episodes take a lot of time and effort to produce, starting from researching, writing, narrating, editing, and adding motion graphics. And that's why I recently created a Patreon page. For those of you who don't know, Patreon is where you could donate anywhere from just a dollar or more per episode to support your favorite creators and artists. Obviously, these videos will always be free to watch, But I would highly appreciate if you are in a position to donate, even $1 per episode on Patreon. Your donation would enable me to post videos more frequently and in much higher quality. I have the link to the Patreon page here and in the description below. If you can't donate anything at this moment, an even bigger help would be to spread the word about this channel with your friends and on social media. As usual, if you like this episode, leave a like and subscribe, and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified anytime I post a new video. Thank you for watching, and see you soon.